I'm Dennis Hensley. It is February 17, 2018. I'm in the beautiful Floral Park home of June and Jack Schwarz. You've been married 52 years. And right before we started, you said you never had a fight. I think that was a joke, or?
That was a large joke.
A large joke? Does it feel like 52 years?
No.
Not at all.
What does it feel like? The time goes so fast, right?
Just unbelievably quick. It's like yesterday that we were married.
What are the qualities that you admire about each other?
I admire June's total commitment to something. If something has to be done, it gets done. I like her commitment to me. If she wasn't around, I don't know if I could survive. So those qualities are wonderful.
Oh, Jack is a very loyal person.
Yeah.
And he's a very kind person. He's a very hard worker.
Yeah.
I mean, whatever he does it perfectly. I admire his commitment to our children, even though sometimes it isn't so easy. I admire his congeniality. He makes an impact on other people.
Right.
And his, you know, being there all the time for me.
Now, Jack, you were born out of the country. You were born in Palestine.
Yes, in Tel Aviv.
So you probably have a lot of memories of being in Tel Aviv.
Oh, yeah. Early memories. Some beautiful memories and some harrowing memories. The beautiful memories are the early days. On Saturdays, my father would take my sister and I, and I remember him holding both of us. We would go down to a river, and there'd be rowboats that you could hire. And he would take us up the river. There was a shack there run by an Arab, and he sold watermelons. This was a treat. We'd go up, have a watermelon, and row back and go home. And then there were difficult times. I mean, my father and mother survived. It brings to mind the Holocaust and the early 30s in Germany, where life must have been impossible for the Jews. For this crazy guy, Hitler, to be able to pick a group of people and just absolutely devastate them, take away everything they had. My family on both sides, my mother was, they were wealthy people. They were left with nothing, nothing at all.
Jews pour into the wasted and sandy acres of ancient Palestine, a home of their own at last.
When he first arrived in Palestine, the British arrested him because he carried a weapon.
Oh my gosh.
A pistol with him. I don't know if he served time or whatever, but I mean, here he is, doesn't speak the language, comes to a country, he's got nothing, and he has to survive. And he worked. He worked in the orange grove as a picker. He worked in a grocery store as a clerk. And he finally landed a job as a hotel clerk. And the hotel was two buildings down from where we lived. Many of the soldiers in World War II would stay in the hotel. So he made a lot of connections with Australians, British, Americans. And he was able to make deals for black market sugar and food because food was scarce. That was how he survived.
Is your sister your only sibling?
Yes.
Yeah, older or younger?
She's 3 years older. I was born December 14th. My father was born December 14th. My father was a disciplinarian. He had a very low tolerance for nonsense. My mother was a fun-loving person. She enjoyed humor. Impatient, but people-loving. Actually, she wasn't that social.
My father
was the social person.
Right.
She was aloof.
In New York City in May of 48, American Jewry joins the freedom-loving peoples of the world to celebrate the thrilling news. United Nations laws have established Palestine as a free and independent state, to be known as Israel.
You were there when it achieved statehood.
I was there the night that the UN announced the vote, the dancing in the streets. And then I remember the morning after, being in bed and hearing the bombs fall. There were planes coming in and bombing the city. And every day having the listing of all the casualties. Every day the casualties. The war went on and on and on. The bombing, as kids, you take it differently. We would wait for the all-clear signal. We'd run out to the streets where the bombing took place. And we would collect shrapnel.
Did you feel like your parents were on edge around it, or did they try to keep a...
Oh, my parents were very much on edge. It was bad.
Yeah.
It was horrific. We lived on a ground floor. Our living room had a window, so that if you were outside, you could look into the window. It was sort of a sunken living room. Our neighbor, Mr. Turnheim, one day came around, and he's looking in the window, and he says, "Mrs. Schwarz, what are you doing?" She was lying on top of me and my sister in the living room because she didn't hear the all clear signal.
She was still there.
She was still there on top of us, protecting us from anything that might happen because my father was at work. She didn't hear it, and she was still lying there with us. All they wanted was to leave Israel or Palestine and join their family that were here in the United States, that were able to escape to the United States. His mother and his brothers were here in New York.
Here's David Ben-Gurion, new nation's prime minister, who solemnly reminds his people that truces don't last forever.
The government at that time was very keen on having people stay in the country, to defend the country. This was during the War of Independence, right after the War of Independence. It took 15 years from the moment he set foot in Palestine.
He wanted
a visa to emigrate to the United States. Of course, there were quotas at the time. The only advantage he had was that the family reached out to sponsor us as a family. I'm sure he paid off some people in the government.
He did what he had to do.
They did what they had to do. The last few months, he pulled me out of school. I didn't go to school. They felt that any day that a visa would come through, they just
once it came through, you had to get out.
They just get out.
Do you remember the day that they said we're leaving?
Yes.
You just packed up stuff?
Packed up and went.
Did you have much time?
No, just go. October 10th was a date that we still celebrate today. That's the day we came to the United States. I remember taxiing off from Lod Airport in Israel. And he was looking out the window. He was worried that
somebody was going to
come
and,
after him for leaving the country.
How old were you when you moved to the United States?
I was 11 years old. One minute I was in Israel as a kid, and the next minute I was in New York. It was like I traveled to Mars. This was totally foreign to me. Going into a supermarket, I'd never been to a supermarket that had an array of choices. That was the impressive thing. We didn't have a place to stay, so my sister stayed with one uncle, my parents stayed with another uncle. I stayed with my grandparents.
So you were on your own in terms of your family?
I was on my own with my grandparents, Upper Manhattan, Dyckman Street. And they spoke no Hebrew, they spoke no English, they spoke German. And as a result, Hebrew was not spoken at all. And I totally lost that ability to speak that language. I lost it. Yeah, so I became American. This is one memory that keeps coming back. That first day of school, my grandparents took me by the arm. There was a public school right across the street. They registered me in that school. They said, "Okay, go to the yard before the opening bell." I'm standing in the yard all alone. I didn't understand anything. I didn't know what to do. Kids were lining up. I'm looking around. I didn't know what to do. I was totally lost. That first class, the teacher wanted to know if anybody spoke Hebrew in the class. And there was no one. I didn't know what was going on. Not being able to communicate, I missed out on those early years of bonding with, guys. It took a while, and as a child, you adjust very quickly. I got over it, but it's a scar. It's very painful. I made several friends, you know, local friends, but it was very difficult. You know, I wasn't into the sports. It took a while, but I forced myself to read and learn. In fifth grade, the teacher introduced me to another boy who lived in the neighborhood, Joe. Lunchtime, we would go out to a park across the street from the school. And to this day, Joe and I are still friends. There's a teacher, fifth grade, when I first entered her class, not speaking very much English, not being a model student, she didn't have patience with me. She was really mean. I complained to my mom. I said, Mom, you know, I hate this teacher. She's terrible. She's so mean to me, and I don't know what's going on in class. So my mother, very small woman, my mother made an appointment to see Mrs. Hart. My mother said, Mrs. Hart, my son comes home every day and says how wonderful you are. He says you're the best teacher he ever had. Guess what? That term, I accelerated math. My English went from a 1 to an 8. That little meeting changed the way she saw me. It was a miraculous turnaround.
Like night and day.
Not only for her, but for me. I was able to really come out of my shell. I think my mother was a positive influence. I remember coming home in high school. My mother said, what did you do in school today? I said, well, we read Homer's Iliad. And she started reciting the first verses.
She knew it.
She knew it, but she recited in German. And I was so impressed. She was a very smart lady. My parents finally got an apartment in Washington Heights, 178th Street. It was an apartment with furniture that my parents got from other people, donation. It was a big deal for my parents. I mean, they had just come to the country, and they had very little.
Was your family religious?
No, not at all. But they did send me to religious school, Sunday school.
Yeah.
I became a bar mitzvah.
You
did? It was important to them, yes. I felt very good about it. This was wonderful. Got telegrams from all over the world congratulating me. I got the little wallets from my uncles with a couple of dollars in it, a couple of fountain pens. My total take was $110. I was very interested in photography. I had a dark room at home. I had an old camera that my uncle gave me, and I developed my own film and so on. With $110, I went with my father to Oldham Cameras down in 34th Street, I think it was. And I bought a press camera with the Sylvania light bulbs that would flash. I was in junior high school. I became the school photographer. I even took photographs at social events, my parents' social events. I was into it, yeah. My father just went out and worked as a carpenter. He was a strong individual. He didn't want to work for anybody. I don't know where he learned his trade. He just picked it up. He wasn't the carpenter in the old country. Unbelievable. The survival instinct was just so strong. That was his life, just to get food on the table. And he did succeed in buying a business from another carpenter at a shop. He succeeded in running his own carpentry business.
How was your mother coping with the big change?
Same thing, survival.
Doing what she had to do.
Yeah, she worked part-time in a bakery. When we first came over, she worked waiting tables, and then she continued with being a waitress down in a restaurant downtown in Manhattan, the Cattleman. She always worked. Work was always part of our life. Summers, if I wasn't working with my father, I worked the boardwalk selling hot dogs. During college, I worked selling shoes.
How was your sister coping? She was a little older than you, right?
My sister adjusted very well. She was a teenager. She had a mess of friends. Very social. She was a beautiful girl. All the boys flocked. She married very young. She married at 18. So she was out of the house at 18.
Up in the morning and out to school.
I went to a specialized high school.
What kind of high school?
It wasn't a neighborhood high school. I went to Brooklyn Tech. So that was a commute, so about an hour's commute from Upper Manhattan to Brooklyn. To become an engineer was my parents' dream. So that was college prep course for engineering or science. High school, I had a bunch of local friends. Afternoons coming home, I would socialize by going to the local candy store and meeting up with all my buddies.
Pay a visit to your Kaiser Fraser dealer tomorrow and drive the amazing Henry J for yourself.
My father had a car that he would let me use once in a while. That was a 1949 Kaiser Fraser. So I had that car, and that made me quite popular with friends in the neighborhood. He'd say, okay, we'd hang around the candy store. Where do you want to go? You know, where do you want to go? Personally, I was self-motivated to do well.
June, what did you know about your earlier family and when they came to the States?
Well, I knew my grandmother, who didn't speak English and was illiterate. I knew my grandfather. My father's parents were not alive.
Did they talk to you about
before? Yeah, I knew they had a hard life. Yeah. I knew my grandmother came on a ship with four little boys, my uncles. My grandfather came here first to earn some money. And my mother was born here. Then everyone was reunited. People spoke the same language, and they were pretty much always in business together, you know, or they tried to establish themselves. You know, I just knew that they didn't have an easy life, but they came here to improve it for their family, my kids. Not any different than it is today.
You were born here in the United States, right?
Yes.
Where did you grow up?
In the Bronx. My parents always aspired to something better, so we moved to Queens, which was a big thing. We moved to brand new apartment houses. They were co-ops, Mitchell Lama, which was a program to provide middle-class housing.
What did your father do?
He was a salesman. He was part of a family business, Corman Brothers, my mother's family.
What would they sell?
Wholesale tobacco and confection. You know, they were little mom-and-pop candy stores all over New York City. I mean, you couldn't go a block without seeing one. His territory was the Bronx and Manhattan, and he would just go to these stores and take the order. We never got the good stuff. We got the broken pieces, you know, the broken pretzels.
Exactly. Were your parents strict?
Yeah. School night, you don't stay up later than 9 o'clock, and if I could watch I Love Lucy, that was a big deal.
Yes, with 100 meat of Benjamin, you can spoon your way to hell.
We went to Broadway. My first show was The King and I. My uncle took me. I remember it was a big thing. He came in a cab, and we went to Manhattan in a cab.
What's a quality that you share with your father and a quality that you share with your mother?
Well, my mother's sense of family and being with the family and keeping the family together. And my father, he had a fun sense of humor, and he liked to dance, and I liked to dance. My mother liked to dance, too. I remember a very significant thing. It was the summer. It was very hot. We always had a car, because my father was a salesman. And we were in Harlem, because he had a lot of clients there. I think it was on Lenox Avenue on a hot summer day. And the Rosenbergs were being killed.
Someone had passed America's atomic bomb secrets to Russia. This was an undisputed fact that the whole world knew. The federal government had laid the crime at the doorstep of two native New Yorkers, Julius and Ethel Rosenberg.
And I remember that, listening on the radio with my mother, because my father was in the store. And they were executed. And they left behind two boys that were similar ages to me and my brother. And they were from the Bronx. And my mother really identified with that family. And she was just, I don't know, she was really an innocent, his wife. I have another memory that sort of related. I must have been about 3, and I was going to go to nursery school. and it was run by the Workmen's Circle, which is kind of a quasi-socialist organization. And I went there one day, and I remember that evening my father said, she's never going back there. They're going to say we're communists. So I never went back to that nursery school.
The thing that the American people can do is to be vigilant day and night to make sure they don't have communists teaching the sons and daughters of America.
It was a terrifying thing. It was the time of the Red Scare. My father had a friend, and someone was sending him the Daily Worker through the mail, even though he didn't order it. You know, right. It was like, what's going on now? It was a real scare.
Now, Jim, what were you like in high school?
I had a friend. I had a lot of friends.
Yeah. Did you get into extracurricular activities? Were you a good
no,
student?
No, because I always worked. I would get out of high school, and I could walk to the subway and go to Manhattan and work at this dermatologist's office. I really was not a typical teenager.
Sure.
I really wasn't a rock and roller or anything like
right.
that. I guess I was more serious, more
sure.
studious. I belonged to the National Committee for a Sane Nuclear Policy. Joan
Very
Baez
important.
Was my idol. I would go to her concerts.
That's
I had
cool.
long black hair like that. I played the guitar. I worked a whole summer to save up the money to buy that guitar.
How did you guys first meet? Take me
oh,
back
that's
there.
A good story. Well, I was an incoming freshman at City College of New York, uptown. And I was taking, I think it was biology. And this young guy came up to me and said, oh, we need a subject for an industrial psychology experiment. Would you be a volunteer? So what did I know? I was 18 years old.
Yeah,
I said
not?
Yes. And he was kind of a nerdy guy, but his partner was Jack.
He's so fun.
There was just that connection that you feel immediately. And I think he had the same feel.
What kinds of things would you guys do together when you were dating?
We're studying in the library, because we were both still in school.
Mm-hmm.
Hanging out.
The whole world loves Tom Jones.
I remember one of the first things we saw together was Tom Jones. It was very risque at the time. Jack was smoking in the day.
Yes.
Everyone was smoking. You just didn't think about it.
Yes, according to this survey, more doctors smoke Camels than any other cigarette.
Well, the data was coming in that it could kill you, but people were still puffing away. And then he said, I want you to meet my mother. And we went into the apartment house. I met his mother, and she says to him, that's it.
Jack's mother knew right away. How did your family feel about
oh,
Jack?
Oh, they loved him.
They just
he was
saw
very, very, very handsome.
Right.
Still is. He was a gentleman, and he had a future, and they liked him.
June's father had a phenomenal sense of humor. He was a salesman. He was unbelievably funny, and I just loved that family unit.
I always did like photography and took a lot of photographs of me when we were dating. We'd go to a market and there would be a picture of me. You
my,
know.
My theme was June shopping. I think it was an accepted fact that we would be married. October 10th, that's when we were engaged. That's when I gave you the ring. We had a champagne glass, and I dropped the ring in the champagne
yes,
glass.
Yes, you did.
Were you engaged very long?
2 years. Married 2 years later, I was 20.
I was 25. It was a very traditional wedding. The most memorable moment to me, I realized that I'm now married.
What's your favorite picture from your wedding?
There's one photograph where we're leaving and waving goodbye. That said it all. I love that photograph.
Today we spotlight the reserve team, the men of the organized reserve, the National Guard, and the ROTC. Citizen soldiers keeping themselves trained and ready to become part of the Army of the United States should it become necessary.
one part of my life that I enjoyed, I joined the National Guard.
Vietnam?
Yes.
You didn't know if you were going to be called up?
I made it a point to join the National Guard, not the Army. The National Guard offered relative safety. The process took 6 months of active duty and 6.5 or 7 years of reserve, weekends, summers, and drills, and whatever have you.
Right.
So that was a camaraderie that I enjoyed.
Did you ever get called for something major?
There were two or three instances where we were on red alert. One was the Cuban crisis, and the other was the race riots in New York City.
In Harlem, the funeral of a teenager who had been shot by a policeman set off demonstrations against alleged police brutality.
We were trained for riot control. Never went in, but trained in the armories, I remember, with the bayonets and the gas masks.
I was at City College that summer. It was just a little bit above Harlem. And I remember it was very tense. I remember Kenneth Clark.
He was one of my professors. He was a spokesman for the black community.
He came and spoke to us and tried to calm things down, put it in perspective.
Tonight I want to talk to you on a subject of deep concern to all Americans and to many people in all parts of the world, the war in Vietnam.
We've gone through the Vietnam era, and you know how quickly you forget that these things really shook our country, and we lived through it.
It's one small step for man, one giant leap for
mankind. I was pregnant with Jeffrey. It was July of 1969, and this friend of Jack's,
Joe.
They had
Joe.
A moon landing party.
That was unbelievable. Well, those were unbelievable times, you know, where America could do anything.
What was your degree in?
My degree was in industrial psychology.
But you found yourself working in computers.
Yes. And I started working on Wall Street in a discipline that was just beginning called computer systems.
Here is management's newest and most powerful instrument for business.
It must have been the very beginning of all of that stuff.
The very beginning of the computer age in business. These were large-scale computers, and the programming was done on punched cards.
This is a typical punched card.
Every card would have one computer instruction. So if you had a program of 1,000 instructions, you'd have 1,000 cards. And you'd feed them in through a hopper. The computer would read them. The computer would then assemble it internally and then run the program accordingly. First job was a programmer.
For the Bank of New York, founded by Alexander Hamilton.
At the Bank of New York, the area that I was responsible for was the mutual funds. So this was the record keeping for the mutual funds. And computers were ideal for maintaining those records. It was incredibly exciting because companies wanted to become competitive, especially the financial. So computers were very important.
You got married, and where did you settle once you got married?
In an area called Briarwood, which was a block from the subway. And I had one more year of college, so I needed to commute.
Both of us were so optimistic about the future. You know, there was nothing to stop us. We moved from the apartment, we bought a house.
Nice.
In Bayside. It was exhilarating, it was wonderful.
We lived in New York and there were jobs in Manhattan. There were opportunities, and if it wasn't this job, it was another job. It was at Allied Stores at the time.
Yeah, I worked corporate offices. And every 2 or 3 years, I would change jobs and
get a better job,
get improved salary.
And what did you graduate in?
Education.
Nice.
I became a teacher.
Where did you start teaching first?
Greenpoint, Brooklyn. My first class was sixth grade. It was a little nerve-wracking, but you know, you prove yourself and you get through it. I liked being with children. I felt comfortable and felt I was contributing something.
Fantastic.
And everybody was equal, whether you were a kindergarten teacher or a high school teacher, you got the same salary because of the union.
Yes.
Yay for unions. I felt very, very accepted and equal. Never really discussed, but we knew we would have children. I was still working and I became pregnant. And I worked until the end of June, which is when school ended, and Jeffrey was born in September.
I And what was he like as a baby?
So mild-mannered and kind, but he was just very complacent and easygoing and pretty much the way he is now, good little boy.
Yeah.
And he always had to be read to. And when I would finish the story, he would say, Rhea again, read it again.
It was so wonderful to have a baby, and Jeffrey was such a great baby to have.
And then we had a second child.
Yes, William.
And, yes.
What was he like as a baby, as a kid?
He was adorable. He was very funny. He would do things to entertain you. He was running around all the time and a lot of energy. They're very different.
Their passions were very different.
Very
totally.
Different.
Yeah.
Very different. William liked to be in the little league. He liked sports, liked to be with other kids, liked to be outside.
What was it like to be a working mother?
Oh, not easy. I remember when they were really young, I'd say, I just want to be able to close the bathroom door and just be by myself.
Yeah, just 5 seconds of
me
time.
5 seconds by myself.
Yeah.
Then there were the after-school activities. Soccer practice and piano lesson.
He took violin lessons.
Wow.
Yeah.
And then there was dinner, and then there was bedtime and bath time, and Jack was never home at 5 o'clock.
Right.
You know, it was always late.
I wasn't always there. June was very much part of their life. I would put the kids to bed. My favorite activity was to tuck Jeffrey in and tuck William into bed at night. It was just a wonderful life. We had truly reached the American dream.
When you told people you worked in computers, did they know what you were talking about?
No idea.
They had no idea, and it was like they had this aura about it.
But I did want to share that experience with lay people, and I approached the local adult education program that we had in the neighborhood, and they hired me to have a group of sessions on computers. And I did that for many years. I always enjoyed teaching. I taught programming in adult education. I brought in the early days of table computers, mini computers.
As somebody whose background was in computers and technology, are you blown away by current technology?
Absolutely. Anytime I go on Google, I close my eyes and think, what's behind all this? Football fields of computers doing this work for us.
Yeah.
God forbid they go down. The whole country is going to become a bunch of idiots.
Yeah.
We'll have to go back to books. Then I worked in the library in an elementary school. And then I was getting a master's in library science. And once I finished that, I went on to work in high schools, which I really loved. Because you work with students, and you also work for faculty. And you had a budget, and I brought up technology to the high school libraries, which was a big thing. I knew a lot of the jargon. I understood what a database was. I understood many, many things. And I wasn't afraid of computers. We had one at home since Jeffrey was 12.
Yeah.
So I always was comfortable around the technology. After I got my master's in library science and then started working in high schools, a student would get an A on a paper that I helped them do the research or finding an answer to a question for a homework assignment. Teaching kids how to search online and how to figure out whether that's a real website or a fake website. And doing special programs, I would have this read aloud day, or I'd invite authors to the library, or graduates of the school that did something, come back to speak to the
kids.
That's
really fun. Were you religious growing up, your family?
My mother kept a kosher home, but when we had the Chinese food, we ate that on paper plates. It was more a cultural thing.
June, I read that you got bat mitzvahed when you were 30. Is that right?
I think I was 33.
33?
Yes.
How does that come about?
It was a program at the temple that we belonged to. And in my day, it wasn't a big thing for girls to be equal. My brother had the big party, the big event. And when it was an opportunity and we had to take classes and learn a lot of Hebrew, and then we had a big celebration afterwards. My mother came from Florida to be part of this. She
That's
thought
amazing.
It was a big deal. It was just a nice community thing to do. I felt more part of the Jewish community because I had gone through this and then became very involved. We both did in that congregation. Jack was the treasurer. I had eventually become a vice president.
We were very, very active in the congregation. It was very celebratory, and it was a wonderful thing. I don't think God ever spoke to me directly, but I have a sense of responsibility to the community, and that's why we still belong to a congregation. It's a sense that if we don't belong, who will? Yes. Connectedness, and yeah. One day we're going to need each other.
Now, you had a big change of job midlife, right? You
yeah.
changed fields.
Yeah. Well, I was very much involved in data processing. I managed very large corporate data centers. And as those companies were bought over, merged, it became almost impossible to keep a sane job. At one point, I felt maybe I could do private consulting, and that was very difficult. I had a few clients I did work for,
sure.
but it just didn't work out. And I decided to move into education. I put my life on hold, went back to school, got another master's in education. When I was evaluated for what I could teach, it was either junior high school math or high school English as a second language, which I chose to get licensed in. So I got my ESL license and became a teacher as an ESL teacher. I love the kids. Every time I looked at one of these kids, I saw myself in them, and I just love those kids.
Was there anything about it that surprised you once you got into the world of it?
How difficult it was. Being a classroom teacher is the most difficult, especially the first year. It is so difficult. You've got to be prepared. It's a show. It's a Broadway
yeah.
show. Five times a day, coming home with papers to grade and coming up with new ideas every day. It's an enormously difficult job. And to keep the kids motivated. And then they said, well, how about you become the school treasurer? I became school treasurer. And before I knew it, Queens College gave me a certificate to take courses at Queens College. I took advantage of it to take
yeah.
administrative courses to become a school administrator. Got licensed by the state as an administrator. And before I knew it, I was asked to become assistant principal at June's old high school in Flushing. And I just loved it. I felt I was contributing. And times were good. Money was there. We had physical upgrades that were wonderful. Textbooks. I introduced technology. I felt very good about my contributions to the school. I worked there for 11 years. It was wonderful. But the world of education changed. It became an ugly political scene.
It's time to come together to get it done so that we can truthfully say in America, no child will be left behind.
The political climate was that public schools were failing. The federal government, Department of Education, they came and they passed the No Child Left Behind Act. That act said that schools had to show proficiency. All students had to be above average. Every year the bar was raised and you had to meet the bar. And if you didn't meet the bar, there were consequences.
Moving.
School closure, removing staff. So we met most criteria. Graduation rate at the bar at that time was 60%. We were at 59.8 or something like that. And they said, not good enough. And they came in, they said, principal has to go. The staff has to be fired and rehired. Everybody got a termination letter, including myself.
Some local community members are coming together to rally against the city Department of Education's decision to close Flushing High School.
The case went to court, and the end of school year, they said, we're going back to what it was. All the firings are null and void.
Oh my gosh.
And of course, by this time, many teachers left. The morale was just totally unbelievable. From that point on, things went downhill. That's when I left.
Yeah, that's enough.
That was enough.
Well, you retired.
Yeah.
I retired, yeah. I started in 99.
Right.
I retired in 2013.
Most Americans are repelled by the mere notion of homosexuality. The CBS News survey shows that 2 out of 3 Americans look upon homosexuals with disgust, discomfort, or fear.
I didn't know what a gay person was. My first job, I worked in a school, and I remember who he was. He was very handsome. And when we got that phone in the teacher's room, you could hear everyone's conversation and
right.
at lunchtime. He was devastated when he got off the phone because his friend couldn't go on a trip, a vacation. So I said, so you go with another friend. But it was his real friend. I put it together when I went to see the film, The Boys in the Band. And that's when I made the connection.
What's more boring than a queen doing a Judy Garland imitation?
A queen doing a Betty Davis imitation.
Did you have a sense of him growing up that he was gay?
We didn't talk about it. It was not part of the conversation. It wasn't an issue, good or bad.
What about you, Jack?
Didn't see it coming at all. I was visiting Jeffrey in school. I took him out to dinner. He was sitting in the car. And in some way he told me, I don't know exactly what his words were.
And the next morning I said, oh, how was your dinner? And he said, oh, fine. Then he said, oh, by the way, Jeffrey told me that he's gay. And I said, he told you what? And I said, oh, well, you know, everybody experiments when they're young. And right. I really didn't think much about it. And then he went to San Francisco. Jeffrey gave me a connection to PFLAG. And I went to one of the meetings locally, and it was a good thing to do. I felt a connection to the people. And then I read a lot of books that summer. It was an adjustment.
I had a tough time accepting it, but it didn't take long for me to accept it. And now I'm totally fine with it. We didn't become activists or in that sense. We just accepted it. Accepting it means that I don't care what he is. I know who he is, and he's a beautiful person, and I love him, and that's all that matters.
He always loved the movies, and that was his goal, was to go to Hollywood and make movies.
I'm William Castle, and I feel obligated to warn you about the next attraction you will see at this theater.
Then it was William Castle.
Spine Tingler.
We went to AFI because it was
at the film festival. And you came out to California.
Oh, yeah. That was very exciting. Then, of course, all the other films. And we went to London.
Ooh, what did you go to London for?
Tab Hunter. Well, we went to follow wherever the films were.
We're his groupies.
Do you have a favorite of his films?
Yeah, Vito. And then, of course, there was a big billboard in Times Square from HBO.
I think it's strengthened the whole movement. I think he's doing a great service to the community.
Now, I haven't met your other son.
He, at a very early age, got married. And his father-in-law was a wholesale dress distributor. And he hooked up with his father-in-law. So he was very good at managing these little shops. Ben got sick, passed away, and William did not take over the business, nor could he have taken over the business. The business just folded. He would call into these radio stations and banter with the DJ. And he got himself invited to the radio stations. And by that connection, he was able to get a job as a technician.
Nice.
In a radio station, part-time.
But you, right now, are logged on to myhiphoplife.com.
His wife divorced him. I mean, it got to a point where she couldn't stand his behavior. And that was a deep decline. But I guess he got involved with drugs and whatever happened. And we didn't know what was going on until...
October 10th.
October 10th, he called.
2017.
And he said, I'm an addict. He came to a point in his life where he says he needs help. One of his buddies sponsored him to a recovery center down in Florida. We put him on a plane, and that's since October, he's been down in Florida. When we were down in Florida, we were able to see him with his therapist and come to some conclusions. I mean, we've been enabling him for years.
Not knowing.
Well, you don't know, you want to help.
We want to help. But, you know, in meeting other parents, we're not alone. There are thousands out there, thousands. He's on his own now. It's going to be very difficult, but he's going to be clean and have a life.
What surprised you about being grandparents?
Beautiful kids.
Yeah.
Madison is now in a musical theater program at SUNY Cortland. Well, Madison has no fear about anything. She just has a direction, and this is what she wants to do.
She goes for it.
She goes for it.
Sure.
She's politically active.
She cares.
She cares.
She's on our side.
Yeah. Right. Yeah.
Crazy. And Avery has just got a very creative mind, and he's an artist. He's like his uncle in a
right.
lot of ways.
Very creative. He gave his mother a hard time for years, but now he's turned around. He's become an honor student. It's like a miracle.
My name is Avery Schwarz, and if you couldn't tell by the wizard costume I'm wearing, I'm a graduating senior at Riverview High School.
This morning, the Supreme Court recognized that the Constitution guarantees marriage equality.
I remember celebrating when the Supreme Court made the decision. I remember texting Jeffrey and congratulating him.
Now, the first time I met you guys was at Jeffrey's wedding, Jeffrey and Palace's wedding last year. What was it like for you to be there?
Oh, it was probably the most exciting day of my life. I just was thrilled by everything about it, just everything. It was a very special time.
Very special, and you know what? I am so happy for Jeffrey and Talis. Seeing all these people at his wedding that are part of his life pleased me so enormously. Just enjoying life, it was beautiful. We grew up very fortunate in an economy that allowed us to save for our retirement, which we are at this point. When I retired, when people ask you, Jack, what do you do all day? I don't know, but it takes me all day. It was wonderful, wonderful.
Great.
It's like a dream come true.
When you look back at your life, what makes you feel proud?
I think the children.
Yeah, that's the legacy. What else is there?
We worked hard and we built a life. Proud of doing the right thing all the time.
What would you like to be remembered for?
That I did my best at all times.
I don't know, just that we were good people, that's all.